Hello everyone. Today we'll learn something about anti-rheumatoid drugs. Anti-rheumatoid drugs, they are used for the treatment of rheumatoid arthritis, a condition known as rheumatoid arthritis. Now, as such, this is a very small topic, so we'll complete it within a one lecture video. Okay, so let's start about anti-rheumatoid drugs. Before going for the drugs, first we'll learn about basic thing about rheumatoid arthritis and pathophysiology, because it is important to know the mechanism of the drugs which are used in the treatment of rheumatoid arthritis. So basically, this is the condition involving joints, right? And it is an autoimmune disease, means it is due to antibody generating towards the system, right? So autoimmune disease, and it is usually characterized by inflammation in the joints, synovial proliferation in the joints, and in the later stages, restricted movements of the joints, right? So these are the clinical features of the rheumatoid arthritis. Here in this picture, you can see the basic difference between this normal joint, osteoarthritis, and rheumatoid arthritis, right? So this is the intact normal joint, cartilage is there, synovial fluid is there, synovial membrane is there, right? So all things are normal. Now in case of osteoarthritis, what happens, that you can say this, the space is narrower, right? In osteoarthritis, space become narrow between two joints, right? And cartilage becomes thin, right? But there is no bone erosion or cartilage destruction. It is not there in case of osteoarthritis, which is a usually age related condition seen in elderly, mostly in the elderly, sometimes in young people also, but mostly in the elderly patients. While in rheumatoid arthritis, you can see the bone erosions, right? This autoimmune response will cause erosion in bone, right? And there will be swollen and inflamed synovial membrane. So these are the basic differences between osteoarthritis and rheumatoid arthritis, and how it differs from the normal joint, right? Okay, now about the pathophysiology. Before going to the treatment, it is important to know pathophysiology. So regarding pathophysiology, I'll show you one video which will give you a clear cut idea about the pathophysiology, right? Now this video is from YouTube itself, and it is by Nature Group, courtesy to the Nature Group. So let's see it.
Rheumatoid arthritis is a common autoimmune disorder of the joints that affects about 1% of the population worldwide, more often women than men. The exact causes of the disease are unknown, but an individual's risk is thought to be increased by a combination of genetic and environmental factors. Many of the genes associated with rheumatoid arthritis are involved in immune system function. Non-genetic risk factors include age, diet, infectious agents, and smoking. In an autoimmune disorder such as rheumatoid arthritis, the immune system mistakenly attacks and destroys the body's own cells and tissues, which immunologists refer to as self. And this autoimmunity can begin many years before joint symptoms are noticed. Doctors can use blood tests to identify this preclinical phase by the presence of multiple factors in the blood, such as autoantibodies and inflammatory factors. These early autoantibodies are thought to first develop outside of the joints, possibly in the gut, mouth, or lungs. Environmental factors such as smoking can modify our self proteins, making them targets for the immune system. One particular modification is called citrullination. When the immune system recognizes these modified self proteins, it leads to a breed of self-tolerance and the production of autoreactive B cells and autoantibodies, and later autoreactive T cells, the hallmarks of autoimmune disease. By the time that symptoms appear, the immune response has intensified and the antibodies produced target a broader range of self proteins. But it's only in some patients that systemic autoimmunity progresses to joint inflammation, which is possibly triggered by an increase in joint permeability and increased access to antibodies. Working out how to prevent this progression is a major goal for scientists. In patients who do develop joint disease, the small joints of the hands and feet are most commonly affected. After entering a joint, immune cells and autoantibodies bind to modified self proteins in the cartilage, bone, and lining of the joint called the synovium. This induces an inflammatory response and activates cells in the joint such as macrophages, neutrophils, and osteoclasts, as well as blood monocytes. Activated monocytes differentiate into yet more macrophages, which together with other cells in the joint produce soluble inflammatory factors known as cytokines. Drugs targeting these cytokines are highly effective treatments for many patients. Left unchecked, however, damage caused by the inflammatory environment can expose new self-antigens to the immune system, continuing the cycle. At this stage, the first clinical symptoms of joint pain, swelling, and warmth appear. Some patients recover, but most commonly, patients develop a chronic destructive disorder. As the disease progresses, dendritic cells display the newly exposed self-antigens and activate T cells in the joint itself or in the local lymph node. In addition, B cells infiltrate the joint, where they proliferate and produce antibodies and other factors, further amplifying the autoimmune response. Cells in the joint lining, called fibroblast-like synoviocytes, also proliferate and grow into the joint space, spreading across to the cartilage surface. These cells secrete matrix-degrading enzymes which erode the cartilage tissue. Bone is also eroded as osteoclasts, which contribute to normal bone turnover, become hyperactivated. Bone erosion, cartilage destruction, and joint swelling cause severe pain, restrict movement of the joint, and in the worst cases can cause joint deformities. And as well as the joints, other organs and body systems can be affected by the ongoing inflammation. For example, inflammation in the blood vessels can lead to heart disease. So early and aggressive therapy is recommended to prevent these systemic complications. By further understanding the immune markers and mechanisms of rheumatoid arthritis, it's hoped that targeted interventions could ultimately change the course of the disease.
Okay, so it was a very wonderful video by Nature Group. Okay, coming to, so after understanding this pathophysiology, you can clearly understood one thing, that there are certain inflammatory markers which are responsible for causing damage to the bone, right? So our treatment target will be that inflammatory markers. We'll see that. Okay, first of all, classification. Drugs which are used to treat rheumatoid arthritis, right? They are commonly, you can divide into two groups. One is DMARDs, that is disease modifying anti-rheumatoid drugs, right? And secondly, adjuvant drugs. In DMARDs, we have two type of agents. One is non-biological agents, and second are biological agents, right? So what you are seeing here, immunomodulators, they all are non-biological agents. While this biological response modifier, they are biological agents. And third, we have adjuvant drugs, right? So in this, we have this all these immunomodulators: methotrexate, azathioprine, cyclosporine, sulfasalazine, hydroxychloroquine, leflunomide, and all that, right? So we'll see one by one all these drugs and important points of these drugs. Okay, but before going to individual drugs, this figure will more clear the idea about mechanism of action of the drugs. Here, as we have seen in the video, you can see here activated TH1 cells are there. which activates macrophage and activates osteoclast and fibroblast. Now, once this TH cells are activated, it will activate macrophage, which will further release these inflammatory markers, the interleukin 1 and TNF alpha, and it will release of pro-inflammatory cytokines and chemokines. And here osteoclast, it will stimulate metalloproteinases or cholinases and collagenase, and it will further cause destruction of bone and cartilage. So here we have treatment targets that all our immunosuppressants, that is cyclosporine, azathioprine, right, they all will cause suppression in immunity by inactivating or depressing this TH cells. Adjuvant drugs, steroids, they will inhibit macrophages. We have anti-TNF agents, it will inhibit this TNF alpha, and all the group, this means DMARDS, it will ultimately inhibit or prevent destruction of bone and cartilage. So in nutshell, all the drugs which are used for this disease, they prevent destruction of bone and cartilage. But remember, this all things are for this prevention, not the treatment of the disease. Means you cannot completely cure it, right? You can modify the ultimate outcome of the disease by limiting bone destruction and cartilage destruction, but any of these drugs will not cure the disease, right? It's autoimmune disease. Okay, so after having all this basic information, I will see the important highlights of all the drugs, that what are the important features, what are the mechanism of actions, and what are the important points, right? So methotrexate is the first drug. It is dihydrofolate reductase inhibitor. We have learned this drug, and you will also learn in anti-cancer drugs also. So methotrexate is DHFRAS inhibitor, and at present it is DMARD of the first choice which is used, right? And they are mostly contraindicated in pregnancy, liver disease, and if active infection is there, because all this methotrexate, it will cause depression of the immunity, so there are chances of getting infections, right? One more thing, there are chances of methotrexate toxicity also. So we have learned that leucovorin, right, it is used for the treatment of methotrexate toxicity, right? So this is how methotrexate is useful in case of rheumatoid arthritis. Second is azathioprine. Azathioprine, it will activate, ultimately see these drugs, they inhibit proliferation of immune cells, right? Basically these drugs, methotrexate, hoike, azathioprine, they are used for the treatment of cancer, right, various types of cancers. And what we do in cancer is suppress the cell growth, right? We suppress the cell growth because there is uncontrolled cell proliferation in the cancer. So here also this particular drugs, it will suppress the immune cells, proliferation of immune cells, right? So azathioprine, it will inhibit 6-mercaptopurin MP and ultimately 6-thioZTP, and ultimately it will get incorporated into DNA of lymphocytes and it will become non-functional, and it will also prevent proliferation of T cells. So by stopping this proliferations, cell growth and cell proliferation, right, it will inhibit this proliferation of immune cells. Third is sulfasalazine. It inhibits these two markers, interleukin 1 and interleukin 2 receptor production, and also macrophage T cell interaction and T cell responsiveness. So here macrophage and T cell reaction and responsiveness is stopped, right? So this is how azathioprine and sulfasalazine works, right? Basically sulfasalazine, azathioprine and methotrexate, both are immunosuppression. While sulfasalazine, you cannot totally exclusively, it is not immunosuppression, it is immunomodulator, right? And it is having anti-inflammatory property also, and It is used in ulcerative colitis also. You have learned that. So it is used in ulcerative colitis. So basically it is immunomodulator, not an immunosuppression, but used in case of rheumatoid arthritis. Now this one, hydroxychloroquine, right? All of a sudden nowadays this drug has become so much popular, right? Because of its use in recent pandemic of coronavirus, right? However, there are so many controversies regarding its use in coronavirus, but at present our ICMR guideline prefers a use of hydroxychloroquine in both as prophylaxis also and for the treatment also, right? So as we are not discussing that, we'll not go into detail of that, but hydroxychloroquine is very, very commonly used in treatment of rheumatoid arthritis also, and it is chloroquine is used in malaria also. So what it does, it suppresses T lymphocytes and responds to mitogens. It stabilizes all the lysosomal enzymes and decrease chemotaxis, right? So basically it inhibits inflammation at the site, doesn't suppress immunity much, but it suppresses inflammation site. And in case of corona, it is said that it is same this function, decrease chemotaxis as well as it prevents lung entry of the virus. These are the two you can say claimed mechanisms of hydroxychloroquine in corona. But here it suppresses, it modulates immunity as well as decrease inflammation also. So very commonly used drug in rheumatoid arthritis. Then next one is leflunomide. It inhibits this DHODH, that is dihydroorate dehydrogenase, right? And by inhibiting this enzyme, it decreases synthesis of UMP. So ultimately it is inhibiting cell growth, right? Cell growth gets inhibited in case of immune cells. It also inhibits proliferation of T cells and autoimmune antibodies by B cells. Okay, so that was all about non-biological agents. Emathi methotrexate and azathioprine are immunosuppressors. Sulfasalazine, hydroxychloroquine and leflunomide, all these are immunomodulator. Means they can modulate the immunity, not exactly suppress. Okay, then biological agents. Means these are the part of DMARDs groups only, but they are biological agents. Means they are recombinant proteins or monoclonal antibodies like that. So they have biological origin. So they are known as biological agents. In this, we first have TNF-alpha inhibitors. So we have seen in this figure that TNF has important role here. Right? So you can specifically, you can see TNF-alpha has role in further progression of the disease. So by inhibiting this TNF-alpha, we can stop the progression of the disease. So that is how TNF-alpha acts. TNF itself binds with the two TNF1, TNFR1 and TNFR2 receptors, and that's how it exhibits its functions. So if we inhibit TNF-alpha, you can inhibit the further inflammatory response also. Okay, in this we have three drugs, etanercept, infliximab and adalimumab. Now these, all the drugs, it's not like that this TNF-alpha inhibitors are used exclusively in rheumatoid arthritis only. These are the very well-known drugs for some cancers also. So there also they modify the immune response only. So etanercept, infliximab and adalimumab, these are the three. While most commonly used is etanercept, it is a recombinant fusion protein, right? So it has been fused with the human protein, and that's how recombinant protein has been invented, and it binds to the TNF-alpha and inhibits it, right? They are usually all injectables, not orally given. So this is the role of biological agents. These are the three commonly most commonly used. And last we have corticosteroids. You all know steroids, they have role in suppressing the immunity. Steroids are used in all the type of autoimmune disease, right? Wherever there is a we can say excessive immune response occurring and you want to suppress it, steroids are used. It is used in all the type of autoimmune diseases, right? It is used even in the inflammatory reactions caused by corona also. So here also due to autoantibodies, there is proliferation of chemokines and cytokines and ultimately leading to joint destruction. We want to suppress the immunity. So that's why for the symptomatic relief, because the response produced by steroids are very fast. So for the symptomatic relief of the patient, we can give steroids. Second, along with the steroids, we have also role of NSAID also. That topic is non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs, right? So that topic is covered already, right? So NSAID can also be used for the symptomatic relief of the patient, and steroids can also be used for the symptomatic relief of the patient. Usually used are prednisolone, oral prednisolone can be used for the treatment, or if you require, then only you can go for parenteral, otherwise oral is sufficient enough. But in case of steroids, it is common rule, whenever you will use steroid for the longer term, all the restrictions will be applied, right? Side effects, immune suppression, activation of infections, all the rules that is applicable here also. So this is how all the drugs are utilized for the treatment of rheumatoid arthritis. But the basic treatment plan for rheumatoid arthritis is that if the patient is having initial presentation of rheumatoid arthritis with the typical symptoms like joint inflammation and movement restriction, first is to give symptomatic relief to the patient by giving either NSAIDs or giving steroids depending upon the stage of the patients, and then along with that you can start this one of these immunomodulators, right? And the most commonly used here are the first is hydroxychloroquine can be used, right? Because it is having, of course it is having side effects, but compared to all these immunomodulators, immunosuppressants like methotrexate or azathioprine, the side effects of hydroxychloroquine is very less. So hydroxychloroquine, if patient is responding good and having mild erosions of bone and like that, you can go for hydroxychloroquine. Then later on you can, if required, you can switch on to this methotrexate and azathioprine and cyclosporine. And these drugs, they are very useful but comparatively costlier. Etanercept, right, infliximab, adalimumab, they are costlier, so they are never a first choice. First go for non-biological agents with steroid and anti-inflammatory, and if not responding, then you can go to the other drugs. So that's all about anti-rheumatoid drugs. It was a small and important topic, right? So go through the all the drugs, and if any question is there, you can ask anytime. We'll post the formative assessment within a one day, right? Hope you have learned something. Thank you.